There are lots of stories in the Gospels where Jesus' disciples just don't get it, right? Peter, in particular, has his enthusiasm run ahead of his wisdom or his ability all the time. Jesus walks on water. Peter jumps out of the boat but starts to sink. Jesus asks, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter gets that part right. "You are the Messiah." But just minutes later, when Jesus tells him that part of being the Messiah means his death, Peter jumps in, "Surely not you, Lord," which earns him Jesus' rebuke, the famous one, "Get behind me, Satan." All right. A few weeks ago, we read about Peter up on the mountain with Jesus, and he witnesses Jesus' amazing conversation with Moses and Elijah. And just as they're finishing the conversation, which is about what Jesus will be doing next, you know, down the mountain, Peter jumps up and says, "You know, let's set up camp and stay here forever. I can build us some huts." It doesn't work out that way. And it's not just Peter who puts his foot in it from time to time, although he certainly is the front runner of the group. James and John, the disciples as a whole group, and as in today's story, Judas, all get rebukes from Jesus for their adventures in missing the point. But you know who shows up more than once in the stories and never earns a word of Jesus' constructive criticism? Mary of Bethany. You might remember a different story about Mary and her sister Martha. On another occasion, Martha is going all out hosting Jesus. She's making the sandwiches that have the crust cut off. She's crushing mint into homemade mint juleps. She's stuffing mushrooms. She's making those little phyllo dough appetizers with four different fillings. Right, and the phyllo dough by hand. All of that. And it's a lot of work. And Martha notices that Mary is just sitting around doing nothing besides sitting at Jesus' feet listening. She comes in and tries to get Jesus to send Mary into the kitchen. But Jesus won't do it. "Martha," he says, "Mary had a choice, and she chose the best thing. It won't be taken away from her." In today's story, Mary is again in space that is risky, pushing the limits of what is acceptable for a woman, perhaps, and this time the stakes are higher. First, her connection with Jesus is now so much more than a teacher and a disciple. The chapter just before this one is when Jesus resurrects Lazarus 4 days after his death. Lazarus's death. Lazarus, who is Mary and Martha's brother. And not only does Jesus return their brother to them, but in doing this, in resurrecting him, Jesus makes a claim for himself as someone who is in command of the forces of life and death. That this resurrection is a sign of who he is as the Messiah, as the resurrection and the life, and as the Son of God. Jesus is more than they ever knew he was. And there is another powerful undercurrent in this story. By staking this claim, by teaching what he teaches, by doing these signs, Jesus has been attracting the attention of the local authorities. And these authorities know what kind of trouble can come from a charismatic leader who starts lighting people's passions in the tinderbox that is Jerusalem. They can expect the big heel of Rome to come down hard on the city and not to be too concerned about innocent bystanders. So there are people out there that Jesus makes nervous, and they've started laying plans and watching for opportunities to silence him permanently. The danger is in the air. So what do you give to the person who has created everything? Martha, what do you give that person, right? Martha has a dinner for Jesus. And I'm guessing she doesn't expect Mary to help cook this time, right? And what do you give someone you know is in grave danger, walking a tightrope and very likely to fall? Mary gives Jesus her abundant, loving worship. Mary, remembering the brother that she almost lost, who she did lose, really, and who now she has back somehow, who she can hug again, whose smile she can see again, whose laugh she can hear again, who she can just hold again, is sitting at the table with them when for 4 days there had been no hope for him at all. And yet she has him back. It's so, so much. And then in this healing, this unbelievable, unprecedented miracle, to see the rabbi in a whole new light, not just someone repeating ideas or even inventing a few good ones himself, but somehow the source of authority, of healing power, of life itself. And to know that in this teaching, in this healing, in this resurrection, he puts his own dear self at the risk of death. It is so, so much. Mary spends a lot of money, $50,000, give or take, for 2 cups of perfume. And she pours it all out in love with her whole self and doesn't hold anything back. And Jesus understands the meaning, the depth of feeling, and is grateful, whatever barriers Judas might want to throw up as a screen for his own dishonesty and greed. What makes it possible for Mary of Bethany to be so open to Jesus, to pour herself out like that? Is that an ideal we should all aspire to? What holds us back from expressing our love for Jesus in beautiful, extravagant, heartfelt ways? I was talking to a friend who doesn't go to church about a church in her neighborhood. The congregation was pretty small, but they opened up the building to different community groups. And for my friend, it didn't make much sense for the congregation to stay in that building since they didn't have the resources to really keep it up. Wouldn't it be better for the neighborhood to have a community center backed by an organization that could pay for repairs and upkeep the building that they needed, pay for repairs and the upkeep that the building needed? Now, I don't know about that particular church. It may be that God really is calling them to go from that place. Or maybe they're doing the exact right thing by staying where they are. But it got me thinking about what worship, what a church community is for, and what the value is of showing up each week to sing and to pray, to listen for God's word, and to give thanks. And somehow, sometimes, I hope, we find ways together to be like Mary of Bethany, to meet Jesus, to give thanks for him, and to pour ourselves out in love and in beauty. That is my prayer, and that is my hope. May it be so, by God's grace. Amen.